one of the hosts of Pardon the Interruption, one of the best in the business, Michael Wilbon, here on the Rich Eisen Show. How are you, Michael?
Rich, I'm good. I just I had not heard that soundbite from Tubby Smith.
I
love Tubby Smith anyway. Anyway, just for years of being around him, and you know that's one of the reasons why. When he first started talking, I'm thinking, well, Tubby, you can't be as old school on this as you want to be. And by the time he finished that rant, that it is more than a rant. It's just a thoughtful, almost a soliloquy. By the time he finished it, I'm going, yeah, he's right.
No, he is. He's got a perfect message. I'm just wondering if the guy who left Georgia to go to Kentucky and Texas Tech to go to Memphis with
you. That's the flaw in this.
Right.
You know, the coaches can be free agents, but players can't. But here's the deal. But here's my answer to that. You've earned that right when you're an adult. You haven't. People under a certain age, which means under 30, and even so more so students, you know, my father used to say, I've earned that right. You haven't. And so, you know, they're dues to be paid. Their experiences to be learned. Tubby Smith or, you know, whomever, whatever coach, had earned the right in this capitalist society to leave his job and take a better offer. It's okay to have two sets of rules, one for kids and one for adults. It really is. As a matter of fact, that we didn't have those two sets of rules and enforce them vigorously is why we got what we got now. You know, whenever I get on millennials and somebody says to me, but you guys did this to us, I say, yeah, you're right. We're at fault because we didn't stand on you a little bit more. And so, I'm not going to have the same set of rules for coaches, and it doesn't need to be in place, the same set of rules for coaches that are in rules for that are in place for 18 to 20-year-old rules. Sorry.
I know. Normally, though, I'd sit here and I'd be in full-throated agreement with you, but what if they're making billions of dollars off the 18 to 21-year-olds?
That's a separate issue. And you know, they should – look, the NCAA can't and won't and probably shouldn't pay players. That's not going to happen. But you're going to have to come up with a better set of rules, Rich. Just like for the NBA, I don't understand what's taking so long to just adopt the baseball and hockey model. One of them, just do it. Meaning you get a chance to go from high school to the pro professional ranks, and if you don't do it and if no team wants you, you maintain your amateurism, whatever the hell that is at this point. But you got to go now for 3 years. And maybe the NBA might negotiate 2 years. Baseball's got 3 years, fine, whatever. That's a separate situation. You can have the Olympic model. As I know Steve Kerr very eloquently, I was out there about 10 days ago when the news about Arizona came down, his alma mater, which, you know, impacts him. You can see it on his face.
Mm-hmm.
And that was before the news that everybody was denying these accusations. But we're talking about the Olympic model. And you know what? Michael Phelps didn't give up his quote-unquote amateur status. There's no such thing anymore anyway. Lindsey Vonn didn't give it up. So why do basketball and football players have to give it up? Why are they the only ones, by the way? Why are baseball and hockey okay to explore these other options and basketball and football aren't? I could really get cynical on you and point out the difference in NCAA basketball and football and the makeup of those sports. But I don't have – not only do I not have any problem with a football player walking off the field at the University of Georgia or Auburn or Michigan or Northwestern – and selling his game-worn jersey to an alum or some other fan or fanatic, I have no problem with that. That person's status, eligibility, should not be jeopardized because he or she is doing that. And so there are ways that people can earn money in this culture without being straight up paid by the NCAA, and I don't know that that would ever work. But in terms of there being one set of standards applied to students and one set applied to coaches, I'm sorry, I'm not going to argue that 18 to 21-year-olds have earned that right yet.
Michael Wilbon, Pardon the Interruption, ESPN.com and ESPN here on the Rich Eisen Show. What'd you take out of the combine, Michael? Anything?
Rich, I don't watch the combine.
Oh, my God.
I know that's blasphemy, especially on your show.
How dare you?
I don't pay attention to it. I stopped a long time ago.
Why is that?
I stopped when I was covering the league. The combine was just starting to become, because it doesn't tell me. It's fancy. It's great. People care about what somebody runs. I don't. Jerry Rice ran what in the 40? 4.6? So why does it matter? What did Walter Payton run in the 40? 4.6? Walter Payton would have been about the what, the 8th fastest running back, 10th fastest running back chosen in that draft? So what? I don't care. I don't care what people's measurables are. I understand it's like a science into itself. It's a fun thing for people to talk about if they care about that. I don't. I understand that it's a part of the way the NFL keeps itself relevant 12 months a year, as if it needs to. It's going to do it already anyway. But I don't. I don't care about measurables. I want to see who can play. I don't care what Lamar Jackson runs and whether he runs a certain time in the 40. Can he play quarterback in the NFL? And we're not going to determine it by what his measurables are. So I can honestly tell you that Shaquem Griffin, I can tell you that he's the only story I've paid attention to during the combine, and nothing of it interests me at all or has in years.
So then what interests you about Griffin?
His story, the inspiration. I don't know whether he's going to make it or not. I don't know whether he's going to be a linebacker or a free safety who can use that speed. And, you know, what turns into great size at free safety isn't size at all at linebacker anymore at 228 pounds, whatever it is. It's the inspiration of having what we used to call a handicap and having one hand. I mean, I understand why it is that people might look at him and say, oh, he's the late-round draft pick, and they don't want to say it out loud because we are a more proper society in a lot of ways than that now. But he's an inspiration. And even if he doesn't play at all in the NFL, it certainly looks like he will have every chance to, and I hope he does. So it's the inspiration, not his measurables. I could care less about his measurables.
Well, I mean, in terms of the combine also, the number of Bears fans that tweeted at me or friends of mine who called me up and they saw Calvin Ridley working out saying that's the guy we want. I mean, that's part of the beauty of it as well, as you see these guys. It's been 3 weeks since football's taken place, you know. I mean, and Bears fans and people can start translating what they're seeing into what they think they should do.
No, we can't. Neither can the GM, Ryan Pace. He didn't do it either. He can't translate any of it. You can't translate it. That's just it. You can't translate what you saw from Jerry Rice. There was no combine then, was it, Rich? Was there a combine?
Yes, there were.
There were no TVs
and all that stuff.
So
you
Jerry
know.
Rice ran a 4.6. What did it translate? I love talking to Jerry about that stuff, now.
Actually, it was a 4.71, Mike.
Oh, my God. You found the number. I love that.
Oh, yeah.
Rich,
it's out there.
What translated? What translated from 4.71? You know, the reason the 49ers understood what else Jerry Rice could do wasn't from the combine. They had that exchange program, which was then called something like a minority coaches exchange, where coaches from historically black schools like Mississippi Valley went out to the 49ers because this was in part Bill Walsh and Carmen Policy and Eddie DeBartolo. They were, you know, I'm sure that Pete Rosen had something to do with it, but those guys were at the forefront of it, as you know. Mm-hmm. And the 49ers would have these exchanges with, you know, college coaches from small black schools, even high schools, and they knew because they saw him play and work. It wasn't the combine. They knew what he could do. And so the 4.71 meant nothing to them, because they knew they had a better idea of Jerry Rice, and that's my only point, that I don't care. It doesn't convey. And it can convey sometimes. Of course, if you see Deion run, whatever it was he ran, or Bo Jackson run a 4.2 or whatever, it may convey sometimes. Just as often, more often than not, it doesn't. And so Bears fans need to chill. I'm one of them. 50 years, longer than most of the ones you got calling you. And they can't figure it out at Hallis Hall. So if they can't figure it out, what am I doing?
Michael Wilbon here, a few more minutes from PTI. How real are the Rockets? They certainly look it, but when it all comes down to it out in the wash, come late May, early June, what do you think?
Rich, that is, to me right now, the central question of this season. It has shifted, at least right now, and I know it can shift again. We got whatever, we got, you know, 5 weeks left in the regular season. It's no longer about LeBron and the Cavaliers. They're on the second burner. The front burner is Houston, and whether or not this, speaking of conveys, from regular season play to the playoffs, James Harden has not shown in the postseason. He hasn't. Chris Paul, even though his team hasn't done so in the finals, Chris Paul has had wondrous games 5, 6, and 7 in multiple series in his career. I mean, he took out the Spurs when they were defending champions a couple of years ago in a game 7, in which he was brilliant, I think, in 5 and 7. So Chris Paul helps that mix. Does he help it enough that Harden doesn't have the pressure and he plays better? or is Harden just going to play better because it's his time and he's matured to a point and gotten evolved to a point where he's going to be a great player now? To me, you got to be a great player, truly great player, you have to do it in the postseason. And so that's what we're looking to see from James Harden and then Houston as a team. And, I mean, you look at that lineup. I don't know what the stat is now. There's something like 27-1 when those three guys, Capella, Harden, and Paul, are on the floor healthy. That's a staggering, you know, record. And you don't have to go. That's not advanced analytics. You're not stretching it. You're talking about the most basic thing there is, wins and losses. So I'm dying to see that. I wish the competition committee, Rich, would just go in now, the NBA, and say, you know, we're changing the playoff format now. Not next year, this year. Because the Western Conference Finals, with no disrespect to Toronto, who I actually think is the best team in the East right now, and no disrespect to LeBron, or the Celtics, I just think that that's the NBA Finals, and we ought to see it last and not as a runner-up series.
Last one for you. You saw Kirk Cousins up close and personal. Do you think he's a franchise quarterback that's worth the money he's about to get?
Oh, man. I think he's I'm going to steal something now from somebody in the league I was talking to last week.
Go for it.
I think he's a B-plus quarterback, which in this day and age, I mean, how many A quarterbacks are there? B-plus, I hesitate because I'm an old man and you know, franchise meant A. I think he's a B-plus quarterback. Like, for instance, if the Cardinals had had him the last 3 years, to me, they'd have been in the NFC Championship game, at least two of them. But they didn't. So by adding him, is he a franchise quarterback in the way I think a franchise quarterback? You know, obviously Brady and luminaries, legends, and Elway, and those are franchise quarterbacks. But in this day and age, grading on the curve, I want him. Is he worth it? He's worth it if it will help me get to a certain point. Is he worth it relative to other quarterbacks making less money? Drew Brees, Tom Brady? No. But that's not the measure. The test is he worth it to your franchise that he can make the difference to get you to, let's say, a conference championship game? And I think there's several cases in which that he could make that difference.
Always love chatting with you, Michael. Always love it. Love watching your show. When you guys brought up the rule that I heard from a Major League Baseball executive about reordering your lineup in the ninth inning if you're losing, and then, you know, I wound up on your stack on the right side. It said Eisen rule, even though it really wasn't my rule. My phone blew up. My phone absolutely blew up.
It should be the rich Eisen rule.
I just talked about it, what I heard. That's it. It's not
that's,
my...
That's, Tony and I are ignoring that. We're calling it the Eisen rule, darn it.
Send my best to Mr. Tony, will you please?
Will do, man. Thanks for having me. Always, I appreciate it.
Always love it. That's Mike Wilbon, Michael Wilbon, at Real Mike Wilbon.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern on Audience.